Today's reading will be from John chapter 21, starting from verse 15. After breakfast, Jesus asked Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?"
"Yes, Lord," Peter replied.
"You know I love you." "Then feed my lambs," Jesus told him. Jesus repeated the question, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?"
"Yes, Lord," Peter said.
"You know I love you."
"Then take care of my sheep," Jesus said.
A third time he asked him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was hurt that Jesus asked the question a third time. He said, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you."
Jesus said, "Then feed my sheep.
I tell you the truth. When you were young, you were able to do as you liked. You dressed yourself and went wherever you wanted to go. But when you're old, you will stretch out your hands and others will dress you and take you where you don't want to go." Jesus said this to him to let him know by what kind of death he would glorify God. Then Jesus told him, "Follow me."
I've actually been asked to start this message off with a bit of a joke. So there is a story in circulation that Muhammad Ali was once on an aeroplane and they were experiencing a bit of turbulence. So the flight attendant asked him to sit down and put his seatbelt on. Muhammad Ali, being very quick-witted, replied, "Superman don't need no seatbelt, honey." She was also very quick-witted and she responded by saying, "Superman don't need no aeroplane. Now sit down and take your seat, honey." This would normally be the time where I would tell the church, "Sit down and take your seat, honey." But we are, of course, not together, and you're probably already sitting down. But even though the coronavirus has meant that our church buildings are empty, that does not mean that the church is empty, because we're still meeting together and we're still worshiping and praising God. And we've got a fantastic message here today. I actually cannot believe that it is 2 years, a little bit over, since the famous Sandpapergate scandal, which engulfed our Australian cricket team. I remember it so vividly. I was in a hotel room in Brisbane. My brother was with me as well, and we were watching all this unfold as it revealed to us that the Australian cricket team had actually cheated. And this cost the job of Australia's captain, Steve Smith. It also cost the job of David Warner, the vice captain, and the position of the very young player, Cameron Bancroft. And I remember the nation was so angry. How could these players have betrayed the game like this? How could they have brought the game into disrepute by cheating in this manner? And we remember those vivid images of the players discarding the sandpaper down Cameron Bancroft's trousers. And it was just something so incredible that we couldn't believe this side, which had such a great history, had gone to such a level to actually cheat and tamper with the ball. But one thing I do remember, in the midst of all the anger, in the midst of all the betrayal, I remember the press conferences of those three young men very vividly. And I remember the emotion pouring out as they repented and they were very, very upset. And I remember just feeling so sorry for these guys, particularly the captain, Steve Smith, that these guys are so young. They're in their 20s and their 30s and they've made a terrible mistake and they've let the nation down. They've betrayed the nation. They betrayed the values of this nation to play the game in the right sort of mindset. And I felt really sorry for these young guys because they had made a mistake. And what they needed was people to actually restore them and forgive them. And it reminds me a lot of the post-Easter story, where here you have a young guy, Peter, who's probably in his late 20s, maybe his early 30s at the most, similar age to our cricketers were at that time. But here you have this young guy, Peter, who has actually failed. He has betrayed Jesus. He has rejected Jesus. He has denied ever knowing Jesus. And he weeps bitterly as a result of this. The night before Jesus died, Jesus could sense the atmosphere in the room. He knew he was about to be imprisoned and he knew the type of reaction that his disciples were going to offer. He knew that his disciples, the 12 whom he had chosen, one of them was going to betray him, Judas, and the rest were going to scatter. They weren't going to come in support of him. They were going to abandon him completely. And there is a prophetic insight into this because Zechariah said, "Strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered." But Jesus looks at his closest follower, the guy who had been with him from the very beginning, the guy who had heard all of his teachings, seen all of his great miracles from raising Lazarus to calming the storm to walking on water. He looks at Peter and he says, Peter, even you, even though you say you would never deny me, even though you say that you would never abandon me, Peter, even you will do this to me. Even you will reject me, Peter. And he says to Peter prophetically, you will reject me on three occasions. Three times you will reject me. And as the night unfolds, that is exactly what happens. When Jesus is taken to the house of the high priest, Peter is the only one of his disciples who actually follows him there. But he does so secretly. He goes into the high priest's compound and he's watching the trial of Jesus unfold. And on three separate occasions, people come up to him and say, hey, we know who you were. You were with Jesus. And on three separate occasions, Peter says, no, I wasn't. I wasn't with him. He denied Jesus just as Jesus predicted. And you know, it wouldn't have been hard for these men to actually gather that Peter was one of Jesus's followers. I mean, they had seen Peter with Jesus. They'd also recognized Peter's accent. Peter was a Galilean. Jesus was a Galilean. They had a distinctive accent compared to everybody else. But Peter still denies it and still says, no, I don't know Jesus. I don't know this guy. And he gets very angry and he gets very upset. And eventually, after three times of denying Jesus, Peter remembers exactly what Jesus said to him, that he will abandon him. He will deny him three times. And Peter gets upset. Peter is remorseful about what he's done. And you know what? I don't blame Peter for denying Jesus. I really don't. Because when I put myself into Peter's position, I probably would have done the same thing. You know, the Romans were not favorably they weren't favorable towards people who followed people who that they deemed were criminals or people that were causing unrest. So the Romans would have naturally executed Jesus and his followers, of whom Peter would have probably been the first one. And not just that, Peter, in the process of Jesus being arrested, had actually pulled out his sword and cut off the ear of one of the temple guards. You know, they were looking for the one who had done this. So I don't blame Peter for wanting to get out of Dodge. I don't blame Peter for not wanting to know Jesus at that time and for denying Jesus. But when we fast forward 3 days later, Jesus has been executed and he has been miraculously raised from the dead. We fast forward 3 days later and the situation has changed. The disciples were in lockdown. They had scattered. Peter had denied Jesus, but 3 days later, the situation had changed. Jesus was now raised from the dead. The King of Kings, the creator of this universe, the one who was crucified, was now risen. He had come back from the dead. And now the question was going to be, what was he going to do with these unfaithful ones? What was he going to do with Peter? What was he going to do with the other disciples who had abandoned him and who had scattered? What was he going to do with Peter who had denied him? And Jesus' response is not to come back with vengeance. It's not to come back and reject Peter. But it's to restore Peter. It's to bring Peter back to himself. And I just want to pause here and offer two quick comments on the lesson that we learn about the way Jesus restores Peter and then get to my main point. The first thing I want to say is this, is that the resurrection of Jesus is not just the restoration of Jesus's body from the grave. It is the restoration of our lives back to God. In dying for the sins of the world, in being raised from the dead, Jesus wanted to restore everybody back to him. And he starts by restoring the very followers of him back to himself. He starts by restoring Peter. And he says, Peter, you know, even though you rejected me, even though you denied knowing me, I want to restore you. I want to bring you back into fellowship with me. And it's a powerful, powerful image. I want you to think about what Peter has done. Peter has rejected Jesus. Peter has said, I don't want to follow Jesus. I don't want to borrow of him. And when you read the story of Peter's denial, you know by the third occasion, Peter's not just saying, I don't know Jesus. I'm not part of his entourage. Peter's actually saying by the third time, he's actually saying, you know, I'm not following this guy anymore. I'm not with him anymore. I don't want to be associated with him anymore. And that's the story that all of us give. That is what our sin does in response to God. We basically are like Peter. We say, we don't want to borrow Jesus. We don't want to be associated with him anymore. We have all rejected Jesus. We have all denied Jesus, just like Peter did. But Jesus restores Peter. Jesus brings Peter back into restoration, back into fellowship, back into union, back into harmony with Him. And that is a calling for every single one of us. It doesn't matter what you've done in life. It doesn't matter whether you've said for your whole life, God, I don't want to know you. God, I don't want to have a bar of you. It doesn't matter if with your own actions you have lived the life of a person who has rejected God. God still wants to be in fellowship with you. He wants to restore you just like He did with Peter. And the second thing I also want to say is that, you know, the manner in which Jesus restores Peter is something that we can all learn from. Jesus is a king, but He doesn't come back with anger, with bitterness, with hostility, with retribution on His mind, with revenge on His mind. He comes back to bring peace and hope to Peter. Jesus is a Middle Eastern man after all, and there are so many cultures out there where if you offend the person, it's like World War III. They never want to speak to you, they hate you, they curse you. But Jesus doesn't do that with Peter. Jesus brings Peter back into fellowship with Him, back into friendship, back into relationship with Him. And I want to challenge you, brothers and sisters out there, that this is a lesson for us as well. We shouldn't hold grudges. We shouldn't be angry. We shouldn't be bitter with people. We shouldn't hold on to that revenge anymore. We should want to restore relationships with people just like Jesus did with Peter and just like Jesus did with His disciples. Because we tend to think it's just about Jesus forgiving Peter and being reunited with Peter. All of those disciples had abandoned Him. All of them had betrayed Him. But yet, Jesus goes up and restores them and brings them back into fellowship. And friends, we ought to do the same thing. Don't hold on to those grudges anymore. Don't be bitter with people. Restore them. Bring them back into right relationship, just like Jesus did with Peter. But I want to say, what is at the heart of this story? What is at the heart of this interaction Jesus has with Peter? When we read the story before, you know that on three occasions, Jesus asks Peter, Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me? What is this all about? Why does He ask him this question three times? Most people tend to think that it's got to do with the fact that three times Peter had denied Jesus. So three times Jesus will ask Peter if he loves him. And it's that sort of parallel. It's like He's unjinxing Peter, if you've ever played that game. And that's certainly true. But I want to suggest that a little bit of knowledge of the original Greek here might actually help us. You see, today we have one word for love. It doesn't matter whether we're describing the love between a man and a woman in marriage, or whether we're describing the love for a parent toward a child, or the love that you might have for sport. It's all the same word. Love is love. It doesn't matter. And the context determines its meanings. But actually in the Greek, they had different words for love. You know, I could describe the love between a husband and wife, where we get the modern word for erotic from eros, you know. And there was also the word that would describe brotherly love, the love that brothers have. It's actually where we get the modern name for the city of Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love. And in this situation, three times Jesus asks Peter, do you love me? And the word Jesus uses is very different to the word that Peter uses in response. Three times Jesus says, hey, Peter, do you love me? And the word that Jesus uses is agape. It's the word that describes the love that comes from God. Agape, the love that God loves humanity with. It's an everlasting love. As the prophet Jeremiah said, I have loved you with an everlasting love. It's a perfect love. It's a complete love. It is a holy love. It's a love that is not determined on how good or bad you are. It's just the love that God has for all of His creation. And it's a love that manifested itself in the way that Jesus died for us. The Bible says that God demonstrated His own love for us, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The Bible says this is real love. Not that we loved God, but that He loved us, that He sent His Son as a sacrifice to take away our sins. This is the word that Jesus uses to describe to Peter, to ask Peter the question, Peter, do you love me in this way? Do you agape me? Do you love me truly? And Peter's response is basically, yeah, Jesus, I'm your brother, man. I love you, bro. I've got your back. And the second time Jesus asks him, no, Peter, do you love me truly? Honestly, do you love me? And second time Peter's like, yeah, Jesus, I got your back. I love you, man. And then the third time Jesus says, okay, Peter, is that how you love me? You got my back. You love me. We're brothers. You love me. And it's this time that Peter gets upset because Jesus basically says, Peter, if you say you love me, if you say we're brothers and you got my back, you didn't have my back 3 days ago. You didn't have my back when you rejected me. And this is what Jesus is saying, that Peter, yeah, I'm going to restore you. But Peter, do you actually want to be restored? Because Peter, you can't keep making those mistakes anymore. If you love me truly, you have to follow me wholeheartedly. You have to fully be devoted to me, Peter. It can't be like the other day where you keep making the mistakes where one day you love me and just because trials and difficulties come, you don't love me anymore. And how true is that for our relationship with God? You know, we want to love God when everything is going right in our lives. We want to love God when He's blessing us with wealth and treasures and perfect harmony and perfect relationships. But suddenly when things get difficult, well, we don't love you, God, in the same way anymore. But this is the message that Jesus gives to Peter. Peter, do you truly love me? Do you love me in all situations? Do you love me on Good Friday when I'm crucified in the same way that you love me when you see me miraculously being raised from the dead? And this is the question Jesus asks of all of us. Do you truly love me? Or do you just only love me in certain situations? Because the lesson for Peter here is that, Peter, if you truly love me, you have to love me to the point of death. 3 days ago, you didn't want to die for me. But now, Peter, do you truly love me? That's what Jesus is driving at with Peter. Peter, do you truly love me? Do you love me to the point where you will even put your own life on the line? Because that's what God did for us. And that's the lesson for Peter here. The lesson for Peter here is, Peter, one day you're going to have to die. One day for my cause, you're going to have to die. And this is the incredible thing about Peter. No matter what mistakes he makes, he learns from his mistakes. And this is his moment. This is his critical moment where from this day on, he will truly follow Jesus. He won't make those same mistakes anymore. And brothers and sisters, that's a challenge for us. Is if we truly love Jesus, we have to love him in season and out of season. We have to love him all the time. Can I just close on this? Next week, we will celebrate Anzac Day. And although we won't be celebrating publicly, it's still a good time for us to reflect on the great sacrifice that was made for us. And if you go to Gallipoli, if you go to Anzac Cove, you will see all of the gravestones of our veterans. And the Bible verse which appears time and time again, more than any other verse by far, is the verse that Jesus said, "Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends." When Jesus was saying this, he was saying that you will never know a greater love than the love I'm about to offer, as I'm about to love you so much that I'm going to die for your sins. But the question Jesus asked in response to us is, just like those, our Anzac veterans, they couldn't make up their mind in the trenches whether or not they loved this country. Because when you're in the trenches, you've got to jump over. There is no time to decide. Do you truly love Jesus? Now is the time for you to decide. Father, I thank you so much for this opportunity that you've given us to gather here today, Lord. I pray for all of our circumstances at the moment that you are before all of those things and you love us so much and you are aware of our pain and our suffering, Lord. May your name be glorified. May your name be blessed. May your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven, Lord. Lord Jesus, come, heal our world. Bring us into right relationship with you. In Jesus' name, amen.
We're now going to give to God's wonderful work in our church. I'd really encourage you to give generously. It enables us to do what we're doing right here and so many other things in connecting to and caring for our community right now. So I'm going to pray as we give to God's work, and you'll see on your screen there that there are various ways you can give. You can even stop in at the church if you prefer. I'm going to pray and we're going to give to God's wonderful work. Lord, we ask now as we give to you, we give with cheerful hearts in thankfulness for all that you've done for us. Lord, you've given us so much. Even though we might, in some regards, be in isolation, you've given us a roof over our heads. You've given us family. You've given us friends. You've given us technology that we can connect with each other. And for many of us, you've given us good health. And even for those of us who are not well at this time, we pray you would provide, knowing that you are God who does provide for us. We pray that you would refresh our hearts, that you would heal our bodies, and that, Lord, as we give now, we would give with open hearts, knowing that it is an act of an obedience that brings you great glory. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen.
Love so amazing.
Thank you so much for joining us today. It's been wonderful to have you with us. We're looking forward to joining with you again next Sunday. And in the meantime, feel free to drop us an email, give us a phone call, and if you need any pastoral care or support, we would love to connect with you and help you in any way we can. Well, bless you, and we'll see you next week.